Guys, just wanted to take this time just to come and celebrate this special day. This is our Good Friday, and as everybody's fully aware, and you've been taking this journey to the cross this week devotionally, it's pretty awesome just to think about how significant Good Friday really is. I'm really thankful to have one of my best buds in all the world, Jeff Smith. He's with us, and he's going to be sharing as well, but it's so cool because when I called him and asked him to just take part, I just, man, just pray about what God wanted you to say and what I'm going to do. And it was so awesome at how literally the open line, what we wanted to talk about, is really the same thing. And so here's the question I want to pose is, what is so good about Good Friday? You know, it's really so cool to think about. Normally with Easter, man, we're celebrating with people going everywhere. It's vacation time. we're planning our big event at the church. But here, as we're in the midst of a pandemic, what is so good about this Easter? You know, when we're experiencing social distancing, and Jeff and I were reminded that we've not been face-to-face in, I guess, 5 weeks now. And I'm thankful for this opportunity that Amen. We can come and share, because we've used a phrase for years that we're better together. And like we've said, I think most people understand it about as much as we can understand it. But man, as we've had to separate for these number of weeks, we realize that, man, we still are better together. Even though we can't be in a large setting with each other, man, the fellowship that we're experiencing, you know, Jeff's leading his life group class through some technology, through Zoom every Sunday morning. We're broadcasting everything online. But tonight, I want us to think about Good Friday, because we've got some people over here that's just so hopeless with what's going on in the world. But on the other side, there's people so full of hope. I mean, it's pretty amazing to know that almost everything around us has been canceled. But I'm thankful that Easter is not canceled.
Amen.
Matter of fact, think about this. 2,000 years ago, as we read the gospel, when Jesus was taken at his will and was placed on a cross, man, there was no churches gathered. There was no cameras. There was no dramas. Man, it was just an intimate group of people. There was his followers. There was his accusers. And I believe that though we understand a pandemic, I think in that day, it was even a greater pandemic, but it was sin. And Jesus willingly went to the cross. And so, you know, as we think about Good Friday, Jeff, I know you write a morning devotion and you put it out to a lot of people. And I know that you've written today on Good Friday. And it's just so cool, some of the information that you're sharing with me about how it's celebrated in some other parts of the world. So what's so good about Good Friday to you?
Well, that was the question that came, because, you know, and you know me, I'm curious. I always want to go back and see what was the origin of it. You know, what makes Good Friday good? Because in some of my research in Germany, you know, it's not considered Good Friday. They have another name for it. Because when you think of Good Friday, what is the significance of Friday? Okay, Good Friday is, that's the day that Jesus willingly, after being brutalized, I mean, almost to the point, we can't get a picture of how he was brutalized, almost beyond recognition. And that without uttering a word, without doing anything, he was nailed to a cross in total humiliation between two thieves, a man that had lived a perfect life. So what can possibly be good about that situation? Well, I don't even know where to start on that. The good part of it is because God created you and I. He created humanity in his own image to walk with him, to glorify him, to praise him. But sin came into the world. And when sin came into the world, we were separated from our Creator. So that separation there happened for the longest time. And as you and I talked earlier, you know, that separation, sin came in, our nature changed. We did things that we didn't want to do. You know, that then God chose a certain people, the Jewish people, and he gave them his law. Even with giving us that law, we were incapable of keeping it.
That's right.
He knew from the very creation that he was going to have to find a way to bridge that gap, to bring it back into right fellowship, righteous fellowship with him. And Good Friday today, that's what we're celebrating, that is He came to earth as a man. And I know you're going to speak about this, but fully God, fully man. That means experiencing everything that we experienced, with one exception. He never sinned.
That's exactly right.
He lived and gave us the example. He lived out really what he had created from the beginning and took all of sin that had polluted and ruined the world. Took it on himself, and today he took that without freely, willingly, took that to the cross without uttering a word, and showed us and gave us that right fellowship with God then in loving us this much.
Yeah.
If that don't light your fire and make it a good Friday, you got some wet wood, brother.
You know what? Just as you're describing that, it makes me think about how on Good Friday, that moment, how literally the light disappeared. The outside light, and the place became dark. And it was in that darkness that the humanity side of Jesus, we can read about John 3:16 and to some degree grasp how much God loves the world because he gave his only son. But in the humanity part of Jesus, we can read it in Mark 15. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? You and I were talking a little while ago about our fathers.
Yes.
And I can only imagine with Jesus, this the absolute intimate love relationship he had with his own father. And you and I both experienced in the final hours of our dads, they saw angels.
Yes.
I mean, praise God. And I think one of the things that's so good about this day, celebrating Easter, is to know that we have a living hope.
Yes.
That even as Jesus was saying, where are you, Dad? I mean, why have you forsaken me? He's not really questioning, like, do you not care about me? I mean, Jesus fully understood the love. And, you know, the thing that we've been talking about since January is an awakening. And I believe when Jesus was hanging on that cross and he begins to, there was actually 7 sayings that Jesus uttered from the cross. And I think that all of those, you can go back and you can trace it. It points to an awakening. And I think, man, there's never been a setting greater than 2020, Easter, to realize that, man, we are in the awakening time right now.
Amen.
Hey, it was dark as Jesus hung those final hours. But I'm telling you, the sun was still present, but it was outside of that realm. And so when I was reading your devotion about Good Friday and just seeing the gospel just unfold, it's the greatest love letter that could have ever been written to us.
You know, and you think about that, you talk about that darkness, and yes, he was God himself. He was the only one. The only one that could take that place to bring us back in right relationship. When he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was demonstrating his humanity. Though being fully God, he still felt the same things that maybe many of you out there right now may be experiencing, even in this time right here. You feel like you've been forsaken. But yes, it was dark. But in that darkness, the world shook and the veil was torn.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, sin died once and for all.
Yes.
For us, because of him willingly fulfilling what he was sent here to do. And that was to redeem us back to the Father. That's the goodness of it. You talked about there were seven utterances that he made while he was hanging on the cross. And you know where what I'm going to say. The number seven is representative in Hebrew as completion. It is the number of completion. He completed it once and for all at that moment on this day millennia ago.
Yeah.
Bringing us back into right fellowship where though we're separated right now and talking here on Good Friday, we as the body of Christ are united in unity and can praise together because we are all of like mind. Mm-hmm. We find our identity in the death, the burial, and the resurrection that we're going to celebrate Sunday of this, though apart together. We're all going to celebrate that. Gosh, that's the good news of Good Friday.
You know what's so amazing is, as I was looking forward to us being able to come and share this time, I was thinking about how many times you and I have said to each other, man, we're better together.
Yes.
I sign most letters, we're better together. I don't think we're the ones that came up with that. Because I really think about this. What Jesus did on the cross on that Friday is so good because he's writing out the fact that he willingly, obediently went to the cross for our sins. He's basically saying, you and I, he and I, we're better together. And because of that relationship with Jesus, it then changes the dynamics between us. Because you and I will disappoint each other. There's people watching. They're going to... We all experience disappointment in life.
Yes.
I mean, I was scheduled to do a wedding tomorrow, Saturday, the biggest of the big. And just like most weddings, they've been canceled or there's going to be a handful of us. But what we see sometimes as a disappointment is ultimately God's appointment. We don't understand why. Can we not have vacation? Why can't we do this? Why did my 401k radically get, and it's been on a diet, it's lost a lot of weight. But I'm telling you, church, you've got to see this. I want to read this, and then we're going to pray together. Jeff alluded to this passage. It's right in the same place from Mark 15. Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of those who stood by, when they heard what he had said, they thought that he's talking, you know, to somebody else. They thought he was talking to Elijah. They're experiencing something. But then it says, and Jesus cried out with this loud voice, and he breathed his last. Then literally, when that last breath exited, here's what happened. Mark 15, verse 38. Then the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. Not from the bottom to the top, but from the top to the bottom. The Bible then goes on to say that there's a centurion that was standing right outside and he saw this. He begins to cry out, truly, this man is the Son of God. There was a witness that saw this, but I want you to think about the fact that we're better together. And you said, what's so good about Good Friday? When that veil was torn from the top, means God was in control. It was torn all the way to the bottom. Man, what God was doing was giving us access to Him. No longer do we need to go through an earthly priest. No longer do we need to have these earthly sacrifices. But Jesus, as John says, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. What's so good about Friday? The veil's been torn.
Amen.
You and I, God sees us. He sees the pain of a coronavirus. He sees the pain and the confusion and the concern of our present day society. He sees that. Some people may wonder, where's my food coming from? How am I going to make rent? I'm telling you this, the psalmist says, I was young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor a seed begging for bread. I'm telling you, Jesus said, I'm the bread of life.
Yes.
As we celebrate this weekend, The resurrection is coming. But on this Friday, man, Jesus laid his life down for your sins and my sins. And what we want to do is we want to take some time and we want to pray. And I want you to pray where you are and just thank God that in the midst of things that we don't understand, we can't explain most of what's going on right now. But I'm telling you, there's an intercessor that right now is making intercession on behalf of us to the Father. And man, what a joy for us to celebrate and open up the Word and get to fellowship and do life together. And I promise you, there's coming a day. And I don't know when it's going to be, but man, we're going to be able to be in a room together. And we're going to be able to just continue to share life. But until then, we can share life together. Through other means. But man, I love you, church. And man, I'm so thankful to have you, Jeff, because I dearly, dearly love you. And I want us just to take some time. And I've asked Jeff if he'll just pray with us and over us. And so right now, as we're praying, God knows, and I just trust that God will answer prayer. Okay?
Amen. Well, friends, if we go into this time of prayer, I ask each of you to intercede as well. Pray for those that you know, those that are struggling, those who have no hope. Pray for your family members. Pray for our leaders in this country. Pray for the leaders around the world. I can tell you the reason Friday is good is because sin has been defeated.
Amen.
If you yourself out there and you're feeling hopeless or you're feeling defeated or just you're feeling overwhelmed because of issues and trouble, know that Jesus said in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer or fear not because I have overcome the world. And that's what we're celebrating here this day. Jesus overcame this world, its temptations, our sin nature, and everything so that we may have free access to the Father. Aren't you glad for that today?
Amen.
Today, I would ask that you meditate on that, dwell on that, dwell on His goodness, find some scriptures to dwell on those things, and just praise God for who He is and for what He's done. Let us pray, brother.
Amen.
Father, we come to you right now, Lord, with hearts of joy, Lord, hearts of praise, Lord, hearts that are overflowing, hearts that really can't fully understand the height, the depth, the width of the love, Lord, that you have for us, your creation. Lord, that you loved us so much that while we were yet sinners, God, you sent Christ to die and defeat sin and death once and for all, Lord, so that we may live in eternity, in glory, in your ever presence. Gosh, Lord, that puts a praise in my heart, Lord, and it lifts my spirit today. Father, we just can't praise you enough, Lord, for Jesus, for that whole gift. May we worship him daily. And Father, today as we prepare, Lord, for the risen Savior, Lord, as we prepare for that empty tomb, Lord, Holy Spirit, help us to understand what that represents, that death couldn't hold him. Lord, that you raised him from the dead, Lord. You fulfilled, Lord, the prophecy that goes back from days of old that said that you would send one, Lord, that would defeat death and restore the right relationship with you. For that, God, we are so thankful. Father, today, in the midst of this pandemic, Lord, though it may look bleak, it may look hopeless in some people's eyes, God, we know this didn't surprise you at all. Father, you saw this coming. You knew what it was going to look like. You know what it looks like as we come out.
God, and we stand on the faith, and Lord, and we relinquish ourselves to you, Lord, because knowing that you are in control, regardless of what it looks like, Lord, you give us the strength and the ability to go through anything that this world can throw at us, because you have overcome this world. Thank you, Lord, for that. We praise you. Father, we pray for our leaders of this country. God, I pray that in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you will just let a spirit of unity descend on them. Lord, in the name of Jesus, I ask, Lord, that you take the division that has come into this country, Lord, and that you just send it as far as the east is from the west. Just let it be gone. Father, I pray for the core of the believers in this nation. Lord, we are better together. Father, may we go outside of the walls, though we can't be in them anyway. Lord, we are the church. Father, instruct us in the way to be the church to this world. And Lord, your word says whenever the disciples ask, how will they know that we followed you or that we are yours? And you said that they will know that you are mine for the love that you demonstrate one to another. Father, may we demonstrate love. Lord, may we demonstrate peace in the midst of the storm. May we demonstrate peace in the midst of chaos. Lord, may we defeat hate with love. Lord, may we defeat sadness with joy. Father, may the fruits of the Spirit just come out of every one of us, Lord, not just today, Lord, and throughout the weekend, but every day of our lives. May we stand on our faith. May we put our trust fully and totally in you, surrendering our will to yours. Lord, may we diminish that you may increase. Fill us, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in our lives. Guide us, lead us, and direct us. Lord, and may we go out and live it out loud for the world, Lord, to see that you may be glorified in the midst of all things. Jesus, we love you. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for willingly going and ending it once and for all, that we may be together with you in eternity. May we spread that good news wherever we go. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, brother.
Awesome.
Social distancing.
Cool.
Yes.
Promise good to me.
The sun.